Good morning, brothers and sisters. And blessed Sabbath to all of you. I'm always thankful to be able to share the Word of God, especially on His sacred day. I know that there's always a double portion of His Spirit He's wanting to give us on this day. So I'm sure that throughout this day we will be blessed as we spend time at the feet of Jesus. I have much material to cover, so I'm going to go ahead and begin with a word of prayer, if you will kneel with me if possible. Father in heaven, more than anything, we plead for your Holy Spirit. We pray for your peace. We pray for your power. We thank you for your forgiveness. And we pray that you will grace us even more on this, your sacred day. As we spend time this morning in your word, we ask for the enlightenment of your spirit, that you may open our eyes and we may behold wondrous things out of thy law. For Jesus' sake we ask, and in his name, amen. You return with me as we go into the second part of our discussion on dress reform. Dressing for success. Can everyone hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay, dressing for success. Today we're going to be looking into the history of the feminist movement and the Adventist reform dress. And like I said last time, because there is so much material that can be covered, there may be points that I may not address today. But hopefully that what we share and what we study together will be a means of encouragement and strength and to help us to be prepared more for translation. Turn with me first of all in the book of Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3. This is a well-known passage that is applicable to us today. Well-known verse. Revelation chapter 3 and verse 18. Revelation 3 and verse 18. This is the message to which church? Laodicea, in the seventh church. And here is the counsel that is given to God's people in the last days. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. I find it interesting that in the message, the counsel to the Laodicean church, we are brought to the attention of the fact that we need, as it says, to be clothed so that the shame of our nakedness do not appear. Amen. Now, we understand that in context, this is more referring to our spiritual condition. But that which is spiritual is indexed by that which is physical. And we're going to be sharing some things with you today that brings that out. First of all, and I have the reference there if you want to take note of them. The Laodicean message applies to the people of God who profess to believe what? Present truth. That's you. That's me. If we profess, it doesn't say necessarily obeying it. But you profess to believe it. The Laodicean message is for you. The greater part are in what condition?
Lukewarm.
The greater part are lukewarm professors, having a name but no zeal. The only hope for the Laodiceans is a clear view of their standing before God, a knowledge of the nature of their disease. Another inspiration. God leads his people on step by step. He brings them up to different points which are calculated to manifest what is in the heart. Amen. Some endure at one point, but fall off at the next. At every advanced point, the heart is tested and tried a little closer. I'm sure you can understand that if you've been walking with God. If the professed people of God find their hearts opposed to the straight work of God, it should convince them that they have a work to do to overcome or be spewed out of the mouth of the Lord. Said the angel, God will bring his work closer and closer to test them. Closer and closer to your heart, your mind, his work will be brought to test each and every one of us and prove every one of his people. Some are willing to receive one point, but when God brings them to another testing point, they shrink from it and stand back because they find it strikes directly at some cherished idol. Here they have opportunity to see what is in their hearts that shut out Jesus. They prize something higher than the truth, and their hearts are not prepared to receive Jesus. Individuals are tested and proved a length of time to see if they will sacrifice their idols. God gives us time. And heed the counsel of the true witness. If they will not be purified through obeying the truth and overcome their selfishness, their pride, and evil passions, the angels of God have their charge. They are joined to their idols. Let them alone. And they pass on to their work, leaving them with their evil traits unsubdued to the control of evil angels. Those who come up to every point and stand every test and overcome, be the price what it may, have heeded the counsel of the true witness. And they will be fitted by the latter rain for translation. Do you want that to happen in your life? Amen. I want it to happen in mine as well. And in order for that to happen, as it says, we have to come up to every point and stand every test and overcome whatever the price may be. Now let's have a Bible study. Go with me to Genesis chapter 3. We're going to have a Bible study today. Genesis chapter 3. Those are just some preliminaries. Heeding the counsel of the true witness, the counsel to the Laodicean church, those who profess to believe present truth. Genesis chapter 3, verse 4 through 6. We know the story quite well. And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die, for God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. Do you think Adam and Eve completely understood the implications of what they were doing? Think about that just for a moment. It sounds simple. Take of it and eat it. The implications, though, how vast, how far, even to this day, they had no clue of the implications. Now look at verse 7. Verse 7 says, and the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were what? Naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. They ate, and they knew that they were naked. Their eyes were opened, and they knew they were naked. Now let me ask you this. Were they naked before they ate?
Yes and no.
Okay. Look at chapter 2. Verse 25. And they were both what? Naked. The man and his wife, and were not ashamed. They were naked, but they were not ashamed. So what happened between Genesis 2:25 and Genesis 3:7 that caused them to know they were naked?
Sin, knowledge.
Okay. I just heard it. In fact, first of all, Genesis chapter 1, 26 and 27. We don't even have to turn there, because there it tells us that God made man in his own what?
Image.
We were created in God's image. And if we were created in God's image, inspiration says we bore in our physical as well as our spiritual natures a reflection of God. Now go to Psalm chapter 8 to find out what it was that God is clothed with, to understand what Adam and Eve were clothed with from the Bible. Yes, Psalm chapter 8. We're going to look at verse 4 through 6. Psalms chapter 8, first of all, this is still referring to man, and it draws us back to creation. Psalm chapter 8, verse 4. What is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou visitest him? For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels, and hast crowned him with what?
Glory
and honor. Thou madest him to have dominion over the works of thy hands. Thou hast put all things under his feet, which is a direct reference to Genesis 1, 26 and 27. Now look at Psalm 104. God has clothed man with honor, crowned him with honor and glory, put all things in his dominion. Psalm 104. Notice what the Bible says of God. Psalm what chapter? 104. Let's begin in verse 1. Psalm 104, beginning in verse 1. The Bible says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord, my God, thou art very great. Thou art clothed with what?
Honor
and majesty, who coverest thyself with
light
as with a garment, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain." So just as God is clothed or covered with light, so it was with man, who was created in God's image. And in his perfect state, man was naked and knew it not, or was not ashamed, because of that glory that he was crowned with, that light that surrounded him. They knew, as a result of their sin, they knew good and evil. Before they sinned, do you think they knew any good? Everything was good. Everything that God made was good. Yea, very, very good. But after they sinned, they came to know good and evil. So what did they know that was evil? All right, let's go back to Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 3. What did they know that was evil? Because the Bible says they knew evil. Now, this, of course, is a basic study. There could be many other implications here, in the physical and spiritual, in other words. But look at Genesis chapter 3, because I want to stick to the Bible as best I can here. Verse 7. We read verse 7 already, actually. Yeah, verse 7. We'll start there. It says, "And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves apron. And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, Where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was what?
Naked.
And I hid myself. And he said, who told thee that thou wast naked? Was he naked before he sinned? But here God asked him a question. Who told you? How did you come to know? Of course, God knew the answer. That you were naked now. Who told thee that thou wast naked? I want to emphasize in this text here how nakedness, or the knowledge of nakedness, is comparable to evil. The knowledge of nakedness is comparable to evil, knowing evil. And of course, we know that was a result of his sin. The knowledge of nakedness is comparable to knowing evil. So what did God do for their nakedness or their evil? He clothed them. In fact, let's read verse 21. And unto Adam also and to his wife that the Lord God made coats of skins and clothed them. He wanted to cover up their nakedness, cover up that evil, the knowledge of it. As time has gone on, as I'm sure you well know, there has been what I call a deceptive veil of time put upon the eyes of mankind. 2 Corinthians 3:18 tells us that by beholding we become what?
Changed.
Now compare this with what inspiration says. I'm just going to move on. I didn't turn there because I know you know that text. A long preparatory process, unknown to the world, goes on in the heart before the Christian commits open sin. The mind does not come down at once from purity and holiness to depravity, corruption, and crime. It takes what? Time to degrade those formed in the image of God to the brutal or the satanic. By beholding, we become changed. By the indulgence of impure thoughts, man can so educate his mind that sin, which he once loathed, will become what?
Pleasant
to him. Who else do you think knows this, by the way? Here's another one. It is deplorable that as the extremists, he's talking about dress in this context. This, in fact, this is a quotation from Mrs. Marianne Caddy, and this is quoted in this book, Thy Nakedness. She says, it is deplorable that as the extremists jump from extreme to extreme, the presumably decent woman follow. They are slower to adopt the full measure of indecency, but each session finds the conservatively following at a respectable distance, so that the modes for decent women today were the extremes of indecency a few short seasons back. So what we see today, we may not consider as indecent, and that is because that veil that has been slowly covered over us, put on our eyes when it comes to nakedness. Inspiration also says, this is from Signs of the Times, when one commandment of the Decalogue is broken, the downward steps are almost certain. When once the barriers of female modesty are removed, the basest licentiousness does not appear exceeding sinful. Alas, what terrible results of women's influence for evil may be witnessed in the world today. Through the allurements of strange women, thousands are incarcerated in prison cells. Many take their own lives, and many cut short the lives of others. And I'm sure we have either heard of or met people who fall into the category, either ended up in prison behind a strange woman, taking someone's life or taking their own. But it's interesting to know here, but as she says, that when the barriers of female modesty are removed, the basest licentiousness do not appear exceeding sinful. But Adam knew evil when he came to the knowledge of his nakedness. In fact, let's look at what the Bible says about nakedness, biblical nakedness. 2 Samuel is where we're going to begin. How does God view nakedness? 2 Samuel chapter 6, as we have another little Bible study here. 2 Samuel what chapter?
Six.
Chapter 6 is where we're going to go. How does the Bible view nakedness? And I'm referring, first of all, in the physical sense. 2 Samuel chapter 6 and verse 14. Verse 14 says, "And David danced before the Lord with all his might. And David was girded with a what? Linen ephod." Now let's go to verse 16. "And as the ark of the Lord came into the city of David, Michal, Saul's daughter, looked through a window and saw King David leaping and dancing before the Lord. And she despised him in her heart." So here's David joyfully triumphing at the victory. And here it says that he was dancing before his people. Do you think he had absolutely no clothes on? It said it linen ephod. Now let's jump down to verse 20. "Then David returned to bless his household, and Michal, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet David and said, 'How glorious was the king of Israel today, who uncovered himself today in the eyes of the maids of his servants, as one of the vain fellows shamelessly uncovereth himself.'" Now, it doesn't mention nakedness there, but in the mind of Michal, he was uncovered. Yet he had something on. But let's compare that with other texts. Job chapter 22. As we understand the biblical sense of nakedness, Job chapter 22. And we'll look at verse 7. Job 22 and verse 7. First of all, verse 6. 22:6 says, "For thou hast taken a pledge from thy brother for naught, and stripped the naked of their clothing. Thou hast not given water to the weary to drink, and thou hast withholden bread from the hungry." Now compare this here with what is written, especially in verse 6, "strip the naked of their clothing," with what is said in Job 24. 24 verse 7. It says, "They cause the naked to lodge without clothing, that they have no covering in the cold." I don't think verse 24. Yeah, chapter 24 now, verse 7. I didn't put it on the screen here, but the word that is used here as clothing in the Hebrew is a covering. Clothing is a covering. And it carries the idea of being completely clothed or robed. Whether it's inner garments, outer garments, it's a covering. And especially the outer garment as far as being completely clothed. Now look at John chapter 21. John chapter 21 and verse 7. This is Peter here. "Therefore, that disciple whom Jesus loved said unto Peter, It is the Lord. Now, when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he girt his fisher's coat unto him, for he was what? Naked. And did cast himself into the sea." The fisher's coat that he put on him was actually the outer garment. But he said, it said, without that outer garment, he was naked. It wasn't that he had absolutely nothing on. The fact that he was still exposing his skin, his nakedness. And before he went into the water, by the way, I find this interesting here, that he would put on this outer garment even to go swimming. But the Bible says he was naked and he put on his outer coat, the fisher's coat. But that's not all. Luke chapter 8. The point that I want to just make here in the beginning is the fact that nakedness does not necessarily mean completely nude. It's being without a covering. That's what nakedness is. Being without a covering. And that covering is full, as we'll develop more as we go along. John chapter 8. This is a very important principle here. I'm sorry, Luke chapter 8. This is a very important principle here that I'm going to share with you in Luke chapter 8. And we'll look at verse 26. Luke chapter 8, verse 26. We know the story very well. Luke 8, verse 26 says, And they arrived at the country of the Gadarenes, which is over against Galilee. And when he went forth to land, there met him out of the city a certain man, which had devils long time, and wear no clothes, neither abode in any house, but in the tombs. Then verse 35, this is after Jesus healed him. Then they went out to see what was done and came to Jesus and found the man out of whom the devils were departed, sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind. And they were afraid. Prior to his conversion, prior to his deliverance, he was naked. In fact, it says no clothes. But he was possessed with devils. And as a result of his deliverance, the Bible says he was now clothed in the presence of his Savior. Clothed and in what kind of a mind? His right mind. Clothing or a lack of clothing is indicative of a lack of righteousness. Lack of clothing is indicative of a lack of righteousness. Notice this quotation. In fact, I have this is from Gwen again, Gwen Shorter. I'm going to read this one first. The Bible equates nudity with moral degeneracy and demon possession. The Bible equates nudity with moral degeneracy and demon possession. Nakedness is a symbol of sin and shame. In fact, let's just look at that a little bit. Lamentations chapter 1. Lamentations, what chapter? Chapter 1. I just wanted to share some principles from the Bible before I get into much of the history. Lamentations chapter 1. Nakedness is a symbol of sin and shame. And in the book of Lamentation, right after Jeremiah, chapter 1, we find the following. Verse 8. Jerusalem hath grievously sinned, therefore she is removed. All that honoreth her despise her, because they have seen her nakedness. Yea, she sigheth and turneth backward. They have seen her nakedness, and this is a result of her punishment, her sin. Nakedness is a symbol of sin and shame. Look at Isaiah chapter 47. Isaiah chapter 47. And verse 3. Isaiah 47, verse 3. Thy nakedness shall be uncovered, yea, thy what? Shame shall be seen. Nakedness is a symbol of one's shame or sin. Now look at Revelation chapter, in fact, we read it earlier. But we'll read it again in context. Revelation chapter 3, verse 18. Revelation chapter 3, verse 18. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear. So in the Bible, nakedness again represents one's sin or shame. And of course, in 16, Revelation 16, verse 15. Behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame. Now, of course, these texts deal primarily in the spiritual realm. But the same is applicable physically. Yes.
Yes.
And that's because, as Jesus says, darkness cannot love the light. It doesn't love the light. It doesn't like to be in the presence of the light. And fear comes out of that. Now let's look at some of the biblical standards of dress reform. We are in Revelation already, so we're going to go to chapter 1, verse 13. Some biblical standards of dress reform. In fact, and I'm going to read while you're going there, this other quotation I was going to share with you from inspiration. It says, dress is an index of what? The mind and heart. That which is hung upon the outside is a sign of what is within. Now, Revelation chapter 1, biblical standards of dress reform, verse 13. This is of Jesus himself, we know, and it says, and in the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the what? Foot. And girt about the paps with a golden girdle. The same description is given of him in Daniel, by the way. But I find it interesting that our Lord is completely covered. Clothed with a garment down to the what? Foot. Let's look at 1 Timothy chapter 2. These are just some principles of dress in the Bible. 1 Timothy chapter 2. And we're going to look at verse 9. 1 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 9. In like manner also, that women adorn themselves in modest apparel, with shamefacedness and sobriety, not with broidered hair or gold or pearls or costly array, but which becometh women professing godliness with good works. So here we find the standards, again, that could be applied to men, but Paul mentioning women here should be dressed modestly. And that goes for men as well. But modest apparel, shamefacedness and sobriety, not with gold or pearls or costly array. I'm not going to get much into jewelry in this presentation here. But the Bible deals with jewelry as well. Those ornaments that we wear for show, really. Here it's mentioned pearls and costly array. Now let's look at Jeremiah chapter 4. Jeremiah chapter 4 and verse 30. And when thou art spoiled, what wilt thou do? Though thou clothest thyself with crimson, though thou deckest thee with ornaments of gold, though thou rentest thy face with painting, in vain shalt thou make thyself fair. Thy lovers will despise thee. They will seek thy life. So he's making herself, of course, referring to Jerusalem here, but the same can be applied individually. Making himself fair and beautiful. But what will happen with them by their lovers? despise. I don't know how many women I have met who used to put on a show, if you will, with their appearance. And sadly, they attracted the wrong man. And that lover came to despise them. It happened so many times. And it ends up in divorce in most of those times. Revelation chapter 17. Another text before I move on. Revelation 17, verse 4. And we know who this is talking about. The one who is not our example, that woman that is Babylon. And it says, and the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand full of what? Abominations and filthiness of her fornication. In First Testimonies to the Church, we're told that from what has been shown me, hoops are an abomination. They are what? Indecent. And God's people err if they in the least degree follow or give countenance to this fashion. Think about that for a moment. God, through Ellen White, told God's people that hoops are an abomination and they are indecent. So let's look at the example of hoop skirts, or what was called French crinoline, as immodest. Here are a few pictures of them. The hoops, or the French crinolines as they're called, they originated in Paris, France. And the skirts were designed with the intent to seduce and allure. Now, you may look at these pictures and you may see some extravagance in them, but you perhaps would compare it to how women dress today. And you may ask the question, what's immodest or indecent about these hoops dresses? But God said that even these are an abomination. Why? Why are they an abomination? These dresses became fashionable in America around 1860s, and they measured about 5 or more yards at the hem. And in the later part of the 1860s, the hoop skirts were actually made a little smaller. But what did inspiration have to say about these hoop skirts? To bring out their indecency and their immodesty. Look at the principles. But Sabbath keepers have a work to do. Hoops, I was shown, are an abomination. And every Sabbath keeper's influence should be a rebuke to this ridiculous fashion, which has been a screen to iniquity and which arose from a house of ill fame. That's a house of prostitution in Paris. First of all, what instructions of God? Let's go to Exodus chapter 20. Yes, Exodus chapter 20. Let's see, before I go on, what instructions did God give the Levites concerning his altar? And we will understand this a little bit more. Exodus chapter 20, verse 26. Exodus 20 and verse 26 says, neither shall thou go up by steps unto mine altar, that thy nakedness be not discovered thereon. So God did not want his priests to go up unto his altar, to build steps unto his altar, because by doing so, their nakedness would be discovered. The same was similar with the hoop skirt. The hoop dresses were so long, they trailed the ground. The objection to this style of dress was that the form of the legs, which was covered with ruffled or cotton drawers, pantaloons, etc., was exposed momentarily when stepping into the cars. The underclothing and form of the women's what? Leg was exposed. But inspiration also says, because under certain circumstances, it is, to say the least, not the most modest, on account of exposure of the female form. This evil is greatly aggravated. This what? Evil. This is God saying that. The exposing of the female form, she says, this evil is greatly aggravated by the wearing of hoops. Ladies with long dresses, especially if descended with hoops, as they go up and downstairs, as they pass up the narrow doorway of the coach and the omnibus, or as they raise their skirts to clear the mud of the street, sometimes expose the form to that degree as to put modesty to a, to the what?
Blush.
But we have become desensitized. There's more. While traveling in the cars and stages, I have often been led to exclaim, "Oh, modesty, where is thy blush?" I have seen large companies crowding into the cars, and in order to make any headway, the hoops had to be raised and placed in a shape, which was what? Indecent. Now keep in mind that along with these hoops, guess what they wore underneath? We read it earlier, you may not remember. Exactly, which were actually pants, which tapered down at the bottom by the ankles. And yet, God still says that was indecent. The whole dress, the whole outfit. More so the exposing of the form. And the exposure of the form was tenfold more with those who wore hoops than with those who did not. Now, we're not even talking about an exposure of nakedness. But the form. But we have become so desensitized. A long process, preparatory process, takes place in the mind. It takes time for us to be degraded. But from the Garden of Eden up to now, we have been largely degraded. Those who thus immodestly expose themselves would be hissed at. But modesty and decency must be sacrificed to the God of fashion. May the Lord deliver his people from this grievous, what?
Sin.
These are principles that she was dealing with in her days as brought out with the hoop dresses. Another quotation. She says, the hoops distended the skirts that they could not fall naturally about the form and give warmth to the body. The extremities were chilled. We talked about that last time. Thousands of innocent victims were sacrificed to the hoop fashion. Going on, this is from the Health Reformer. We cannot, if we would, conceal the fact that women have feet and limbs that were made for use. But in regard to the exposure, this is on the other side of the question. We have traveled extensively the past 25 years and have been eyewitnesses to many indecent exposures of the limbs. Indecent exposure of the limb. Indecent. But we have been desensitized. But the most common exposure is seen upon the streets in light snow or wet and mud. Both hands are required to elevate the dress that it may clear the wet and filth. It is a common thing to see the dress raised how far? One half of a yard. That's to about... Is that very far? It's not like they raise it way up here. But they raise it to show this much. And God was saying that's an abomination. Wow. This is not extreme. This is God showing us his love. This is God wanting us that we may be clothed with his righteousness. And as we are so degraded by what is going on in our society, that has a spiritual impact on us. And if we are not standing tall for the word of God, as inspiration says, if we give in to the customs of this world, we will not find it hard to yield to the powers that be. Amen. Exposing an almost unclad ankle to the sight of gentlemen. I didn't say that. But no one seems to blush at this immodest exposure. No one seems to blush at it. How far have we gone away? No one's sensitive modesty seems shocked for the reason that this is customary. It is fashion, and for this reason, it is endured. No outcry of immodesty is heard, although it is so in the fullest sense. This is what God was saying in her days in referring to the hoop dresses and what it exposed. Do we serve the same God? Do you think he has changed in his principles? There's more. God made man in the beginning with a very sensitive, this is from Joe Cruz, in his book Creeping Compromise, which is a very thorough book written by the elder. God made man in the beginning with a very sensitive sexual nature that could be quickly aroused by the sight of female nudity. Woman, on the other hand, was created with a sensual nature which would not be so easily stirred, especially by sight. She was made to be more responsive to touch and tenderness. Her more subtle sexuality could be drawn out by the physical attentions involved in a conjugal relationship. But mark this. God never intended for man's sex emotions to be stimulated outside the marriage chamber. And in order to protect him, God placed within the woman a delicate sense of modest reserve that Satan has been stripping more and more away from women so that she would not expose her body except to her own husband. Another gentleman by the name of Harold Martin wrote a book, The Hazards of Immodest Dress. I can't remember the page number, so I don't have it. But he says, men too should avoid tendencies toward nakedness. When men strut around wearing only the briefest of shorts, this is far from modesty. You're still exposing your nakedness. When at picnic tables or at their places of work, they appear stripped to the waist. And I'm sure we all perhaps have seen that in our time. It is hard to believe that such an appearance represents an attire that becometh saints. So let's look a little bit into this history of the feminist movement. In 1862, a spokesman who promoted women's health addressed a large audience in Washington, D.C. And he made the following statement regarding the disadvantages and tortures of the women of the day, not only as a result of the hoop dresses, which was a great disadvantage for women, not just modestly speaking, but health-wise as well. The weight of the dresses, the fact that they could never do anything productive because they were always having to pull up the dresses. Women actually were crying out about that at the time. And then they had the corsets which were compressing the waist in. I have a picture, but I didn't put it on my screen here, of pictures of women who for a long time wore those tights and how their form began to be shaped into the form of the corsets, which was pressing in their internal organs, not allowing them to function as they should. So there were people talking about the disadvantages and tortures of the women of the day. And this is what this spokesman said in 1862. Women's clothing is arranged with such an eye to inconvenience and burdensomeness that if they go out at all, it is under great disadvantage. If they should cross the threshold, they may dampen their feet and soil their skirts on the steps and have their unprotected limbs chilled by the wind. If they wish to walk, they must wait till the dew is off the grass, and a sultry summer sun detracts from the benefit of it. If they work in the garden, more strength is expended on account of the dress than with the plants. For it not only is so arranged that they cannot make a motion easily, but it must be gathered up in their arms while they work with their hands. If they go to market, they must carry skirts as well as a basket, for dew, dust, mud, or snow has to be cleared. If they ride, they must be lifted in and out of the carriage while they take care of their skirts. And even then, they are often caught and have to be extricated from them. And if by accident any danger comes to life or limb in carriage or on horseback, it is tenfold greater on account of such shackling garments. And this was given by Ellen Harmon at the time, Ellen Beard Harmon, which is very interesting. See, there were a push for dress reform nationwide in the 1860s and 70s and onwards. It wasn't just God's people. But we need to understand the feminist movement that was pushing forward. Now, this was not the only voice of protest in the days. 11 years earlier, there was a member of Congress, Jarrett Smith, who said the following. He says, "A reformation in the dress of women is very much needed. It is indispensable to her health and usefulness. While in the prison of the present dress, she is and ever will remain comparatively unhealthy and useless." That's what a Congress, Jarrett Smith, said. And here is a picture of what came to be known as the American costume. About the same time, Mr. Jarrett Smith's daughter, the congressman's daughter, her name was Elizabeth Smith Miller, she launched a revolt to free women from their closed prison. And she adopted a dress that was modeled after the style of the Turkish costume, which you see here. That was the style that she modeled it off of. And after wearing the dress for about 3 months, she went to Seneca Falls, New York. And she went there to visit her cousin by the name of Elizabeth Cady Stanton. And she, her cousin, was one of the honored ladies of the nation because of her efforts in the feminist movement. And because she liked the advantages and freedom and comfort of the costume that was worn by her cousin, she also adopted a dress that was made in a similar style. And on the left here, you have more of a picture of the dress that she adopted. Now, there was a lady who also lived in Seneca Falls, New York, by the name of Emilia Bloomer. And she held a very important, very prominent role in the feminist movement, because she was an editor of the magazine called The Lily, and it was a monthly women's temperance magazine. And as she came into contact with Elizabeth, who also lived in Seneca Falls, she saw the novelty of the new uniform of Elizabeth, and she admired it. And soon she became the third member of this trend of dress reformers. Now, in the issue of her journal for March of 1851, she described and praised the costume. And in the following month, she announced her personal adoption of it. She says, "Readers, ours, behold us now in short dress and trousers. And then, if you please, give free vent to your feelings on the subject, praise or blame, approve or condemn, as might suit you best. We have become used to both and are indifferent as to your opinion." Now, this style of dress, as you see in the picture, was consisted of pants under a dress. It went through various changes and was eventually dubbed the American costume. And in May of 1851, Emilio Bloomer introduced Susan B. Anthony. It may ring a bell to some of you. She was a spiritualist. She introduced her to Elizabeth Cady Stanton, and this is actually a statue of that introduction. And all these ladies were women's rights activists. Inspiration says, "Those who feel called out to join the movement in favor of women's rights and the so-called dress reform might as well," what? "Sever all connection with the third angel's message. The spirit which attends the one cannot be in harmony with the other." And in fact, this same principle is applicable to certain social movements of our day. The spirit that is in these movements do not harmonize with the work of the third angel's message, with present truth. But why was God so opposed to this style of dress? time goes so fast.
It was too much like men's clothing.
Exactly. Deuteronomy chapter 22, verse 5. Let's just turn it. Can I have 5 more minutes? All right. I will not be able to cover as much as I wanted to today. Deuteronomy chapter 22. This is why God was so opposed to this style of dress. Deuteronomy 22 and verse 5. Yes. The woman shall not wear that which pertaineth unto a man, neither shall a man put on a woman's garments. For all that do so are abomination unto the Lord thy God. What does inspiration have to say about this? Let's just read a few passages. Testimonies to the Church, Volume 1 says, I saw that God's order has been reversed. God's what has been reversed? God has an order. When it comes to men, women, God has an order. And his special directions disregarded by those who adopt the American costume. Now, we saw pictures of how it looked. Kind of like the Turkish style. I was referred to Deuteronomy 22:5. The woman shall not wear that which pertaineth unto a man, neither shall a man put on a woman's garment. For all that do so are an abomination unto the Lord thy God. God would not have his people adopt the so-called reform dress. It is immodest apparel, wholly unfit for the modest, humble followers of Christ. This is what she said about the American costume. It was immodest and wholly unfit for the modest, humble follower of Christ. There is an increasing tendency to have women in their dress and appearance as near like the other sex as possible, and to fashion their dress very much like that of men. But God pronounces it. This is the same God that we serve today. The same God who is wanting us to come up higher, to come closer unto him. As I said in the beginning, our nakedness is indicative of what's in our mind. In wide contrast with this modest dress is the so-called American costume, resembling very near the dress worn by men. It consists of a vest, pants, and a dress resembling a coat and reaching about halfway from the hip to the knee. No nakedness, but still immodest. This dress I have opposed from what has been shown me as in harmony with the Word of God, while the other I have recommended as modest, comfortable, convenient, and helpful. And what contrast to what dress? Well, sadly, I'm out of time, but yes.
So the objection was that the dress was mid-thigh instead of below the knee?
Not so much that. It was that it was in the appearance as what men wore. Yeah, let's look at that quotation again. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but that wasn't the primary objection.
Length is not the issue.
It wasn't the length. I was planning to get to that.
Okay, it says halfway from the hip to the knee.
Right.
Yeah, but
that wasn't the issue. She was just explaining what it is. The issue is that it says the second, well, let's read the first one. It says, and highlight it, it says dress. I'll just read the whole. There's an increasing tendency to have women in their dress and appearance as near like the other sex as possible, and to fashion their dress or to make their dress very much like that of men, but God pronounces it an abomination. The issue was that it resembles that of men. Just like the next quotation. The so-called American costume resembling very nearly the dress worn by men. That's the issue. This dress I have opposed. Yes, it reaches to half the knee, but guess what? It still had pants underneath. Then there was the Adventist Reformed dress. And I believe that time goes so fast, I had much more to cover. Like I said, Lord's willing, I will be putting these out on series here to consider this. But the Adventist Reformed dress was the dress that was ordained of God. And I'll just say real quickly, sadly, as time went on, God's people were adopting this dress, which was more modest. It came down to close to the ankle, and they still had pants underneath it. They wore that dress, but the brethren, the women, considered it to be objectionable because of its appearance. And soon the dress was given up. But there were still principles that God gave them in place of that, to how they should wear their clothing. But here's a little picture here of what the Reformed dress would have looked like.
Is this the one that Ellen White approved of?
Exactly. Yes, that's the one that she approved of. It was also called the short dress. And many people think that it was called the short dress, meaning that it came up to the knee or something like that. It was short because it was shorter than the dresses of the day, the hoop dress, especially that went up on the ground. It came up between 8 and 9 inches from the floor.
It wouldn't be dragging the dirt.
And yet it was long enough to hide the form of the legs and keep the legs warm.
Men are included now. They got feminine stuff for men.
I'm sorry?
Feminine stuff for men.
Yeah, I was going to get into some of that, but I knew I had this material that I wanted to just give a snippet here of the feminist movement and how, believe it or not, that movement is still pressing. There are so many implications of what we're reading. And it has infected us. It has so desensitized us. And as we become desensitized to those things, that can open us up to the enemy's influence. And I'm sure none of us here want that. We read earlier of the demoniac and how, though he was naked prior to his encounter with Christ, afterwards he was clothed and in his right mind. Amen. So by God's grace, I will have another opportunity to share these things with you. And like I said, if you can go to our website to find out a little bit more about our broadcast, and I hope to finish going through this series on dress reform, because God is calling us up higher. I wasn't able to get much into the pants or even the women's head covering, etc. But there are principles that God is wanting us to know and not go to extremes. But I would be more than happy to talk with any of you or to finish it up on a personal level if you want to still hear the thoughts that I have to share with you. But I think I shared enough for us to understand what is at stake and that we have been desensitized. We need to understand what nakedness is. Evil in the eyes of God, and he wanted us to be covered as the picture is given us of Christ, clothed with the garment down to his foot. So may the Lord help us that we would have that influence in this world. Yes.
I'd be willing to stay another 10 or 15 minutes for you to finish the presentation.
We have a rehearsal.
For those of us who want to, okay, I'll close it with prayer. You have a rehearsal in this room?
Yeah. Well, we could go in the other room.
No, we need that.
Yeah. We need this piece.
Okay. Well, maybe afterwards. We'll see. Maybe some break time. We'll have time for a break.
Maybe you can go to the other room.
Maybe I can do that. There is a screen over there.
Yeah.
So let's close with prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you for your word. And you have given us enough this morning for us to understand simply the standards that you have called us to. I pray that it would be in the minds and heart of us each to consider to continue to study this out, recognizing that I didn't share that quotation, but inspiration tells us that this is not to be made a test question in regards to dress reform. But there are principles that God has given us because he is seeking to prepare us for translation. So we pray, Father, that your spirit will abide in our hearts and cleanse us from all moral defilement that we read about earlier. As we come up step by step, and as every test is implied by your spirit, closer and still closer that we may pass each test and come closer to you. And it is only as we come closer to you, whatever the price may be, that we can come closer to one another. Amen. So we pray for your Spirit to help that, work that out in our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.